the CISG, apart from examining the goods and giving notice of lack of conformity as soon as possible. The most obvious obligation, of course, is to pay the price. The second fundamental obligation of the buyer is also related to the examination of the goods, is the obligation to take delivery of the goods. These two obligations are reflected in Articles 53 and 60 of the CISG. In concrete terms, that means that the buyer has also a duty to cooperate with the seller to effect delivery of the goods. For example, if the sale involves carriage of goods, the buyer has to arrange for the carriage of the goods, unless it has been agreed with the buyer, with the seller, that the seller would do that. And that is a duty to cooperate to ensure that the seller is able to deliver the goods to the buyer, right? Giving notice to the seller, for instance, of the ship and location of the ship and the docks where the goods would have to be loaded for carriage to the buyer. Again, is an obligation of the buyer. The seller, if the seller has not arranged for the transportation, the seller will not know of that. And the buyer is under duty to cooperate with the seller to make that possible. And then, obviously, the obligation to physically take over the goods. The seller cannot incur the cost of having to store the goods somewhere because the buyer shows up too late at the harbor to pick up the goods. The buyer has to be there on time in order to clear the goods through customs and also pick up the goods and bring it to its own place of business. However, the buyer also has the right to reject the goods if they are delivered before the date. We heard that yesterday. Early delivery is a breach of contract because the buyer may not be prepared to receive the goods at that point in time. And the buyer can also reject the goods if the seller delivers a quantity that exceeds the quantity agreed in contract. The buyer, however, does not have a blank general right to reject the goods for lack of quality or for they otherwise lacking conformity to the contract unless that lack of conformity amounts to a fundamental breach of contract, and we'll see in a minute what that means. Now, regarding payment of price, the CISG assumes that's the default position under the CISG. Simultaneous price payment and delivery of goods. That's the default rule on the CISG. You pay against delivery. So if nothing else is specified, that's the obligation of the buyer to pay from the moment that the seller places the goods at the buyer's disposal or otherwise delivers to the buyer the documents that would allow the buyer to take possession of the goods. And that is the default point in time for payment. However, the buyer is not bound to pay the goods, obviously, unless otherwise agreed, until it has had an opportunity to inspect the goods. You remember I mentioned yesterday the principle of also mitigation of damage. That's also part of the philosophy of the CISG. If the buyer pays before the buyer is able to examine, maybe that the buyer would have then a right to claim that payment back. And then to simplify things, the CISG puts them in the logical order. First, you inspect the goods, and then you have an obligation to pay. Again, as regards the then time of payment, it has to be, if there is a fixed time in the contract at the moment that the parties have agreed that payment has to be made, without further notice. It's an automatic obligation. There are some systems that makes the obligation to pay a sum of money enforceable upon notice by the creditor. This is not necessary under the CISG. It's an automatic obligation. So, there is, however, no provision on the CISG for the currency of payment. I mentioned this in the introduction, general introduction to this CISG. And this is an internal gap on the CISG, which is solved on the basis of its internal logic and the underlying principles of the CISG. And in this case, it means that the currency of payment, unless otherwise agreed, it will be the currency of the place of delivery. You pay in the local currency, the place where you effect delivery of the goods. The loss of damage to the goods after the risk has passed to the buyer will not release the buyer from the obligation to pay for the goods. And you remember the questions concerning the linkage between risk of damage and property rights. This notion in the CISG is a reflection of that principle that a thing is lost to its owner. And here is the same idea. Since I have assumed the risk, if the thing gets lost in transportation, it is my loss, but I still have to pay to the seller, because at that point in time, the seller no longer bears the risk of loss or damage to the goods. We'll see now, what does that mean, the passage of risk under the CISG? And when you talk about the performance of the contract, before we then move to remedies for breach of contract. The provision on Article 67 of the CISG is that if the contract involves carriage, right, and the seller is not obliged to deliver the goods at a particular location, the risk will pass in the moment that the seller delivers the good to the first carrier that will bring them to the buyer. The underlying logic of this provision should be evident. It's because at that point in time, the seller is no longer in control of the goods and is not logical for the seller to bear the risk if they are lost. And why is it that it should be the buyer? Because the logic of any sales contract is that it is the buyer who arranged for the carriage. The carriage is arranged on behalf of the buyer, and very often, even if it is this, in practical terms, the seller that arranged for the carriage, that is done to the benefit of the buyer. And that's why the buyer should bear the risk from that point in time on. You see that there are various contract practical arrangements for shifting this risk from one point in time to the other. We'll see that in a moment. But that is the basic provision. What do we mean then here by saying then if the seller has to deliver the goods at a certain point? You see there are terms of carriage that would contemplate that the carriage begins at the premises of the seller, or that the carriage would begin at the harbor, or that the carriage would begin on the ship. There are various terms that parties may be used, and these are commercial arrangements related to cost and insurance. And this is what the CISG has in mind in this provision. It is drafted in a way that can accommodate contractual arrangements on the parties for the logistics of the transportation. If, however, there is no carriage of goods involved, and obviously is the moment of the immediate delivery from the seller to the buyer, or the moment where the seller puts the goods at the disposal of the buyer, perhaps at its own premises. However, the risk would not pass until the goods have been identified to the contract. For example, if you are purchasing coffee beans, and the contract terms are that you pick them up at the warehouse of the coffee bean grower, the risk could only pass to you the moment that the seller has identified which are your coffee beans as within that volume of coffee beans that is stored in the seller's warehouse. Until that moment, the risk cannot pass to the buyer. And I come back to that point. This is regardless of whether the buyer has acquired ownership to the goods or not. Again, this is outside the CISG. And for the purpose of the CISG, the system works very well, and you don't need to wonder who has become the owner at which point in time. It all relates to the arrangements of the parties concerning the contract of carriage. The handing over of goods under the CISG means physical handover, actual surrender of the goods to the carrier. It's not the same thing as the delivery of the documents. Here we need the carrier to actually take over the goods. Now, depending on the means of transportation I mentioned to you, the risk may pass at the premises of this seller. The other extreme position, the risk could pass only upon delivery to the premises of the buyer. Most often it happens somewhere in between, and that's related to the type of sea carriage that is chosen by the parties. It can also be air carriage, but as you know, most of the world trading goods is shipped by ocean means of transportation. And here you have the main terms that are used in practice. And these are terms that are compiled and explained by the International Chamber of Commerce, the so-called Incoterms. You probably heard that expression before. International commercial terms, Incoterms. And these are simple acronyms, basically a glossary of terms. Each of them signifies a particular arrangement between the parties as to the cost of the carriage, right? The insurance, and the point in time when risk will pass to the buyer, right? And you see, for example, the first term is called FAS, free alongside ship. It means the seller has delivered the goods when they are placed alongside the ship, before they start being loaded on the ship. And from that moment on, it is the buyer's responsibility to ensure that the goods are loaded on the ship and carried to the final destination. That also means that the risk of damage to the goods will stop or pass from the buyer from the seller to the buyer at that point in time. Under the FOB contract, though, it's called free on board, means the risk will pass when the goods are loaded on the ship. And from that point on, the risk runs to the buyer. You may ask me now, what is the difference? What is the significance between putting on the docks or after loading on the ship? Because in practice, most damage occurs exactly at that point in time, in that operation, lifting the goods and placing them on the vaults of the ship. And if I don't want to take that risk, I'll sell the goods on an FAS term because I don't want to run the risk of damage load. I don't trust the terminal operators. I don't trust the equipment in the harbor. And I tell the buyer, you take care of that. And this can go all the way to the R extreme, the CIF terms, where the buyer would also the seller would also be covering the cost of the transportation to the destination. Whereas in the free on board, it means I cover only the cost up to here. In this case, typically the seller would be arranging the shipment to the benefit of the buyer, maybe because the seller has better access to better transportation terms. But the risk would still be passing when you load the goods on the ship. It's just different contractual arrangements in terms of cost allocation. Those are the most common terms in international trade, FOB and CIF. And you see, from that point on, there's the buyer's risk. So whatever happens during the voyage is the buyer's risk. Even if the contract would have been concluded in terms such that the buyer would have become the actual owner only upon delivery of the bills of lading to the buyer in the final port of destination. But that for the CISG doesn't matter. Okay? So this is why the CISG structures the notion of passage of risk connected to the notion of carriage, because this relates also to the commercial arrangements that the parties will be making at their choice. Now, let's begin with the remedies of the buyer, unless you have any questions so far on this point. Yes, please. Yes.
So basically, it is possible to make the guaranteed period more than 2 years, and in that case, if the guaranteed period is more than 2 years, so can we apply to the court because of some damages after 2 years, or just 2 years according to CISG?
Well, there are two things here. One is a contractual period of guarantee is a contractual period of guarantee between the seller and the buyer. And I can offer you a warranty that goes beyond 2 years. It's freedom of contract under the CISG. Or you may agree to waive the 2 years and say, a contract and say, no claims will be accepted beyond 1 year. This is possible because the entire CISG can be derogated by the party. The other thing is your relationship with the carrier and the terminal operator or anyone else that handles the carriage of goods. This is a separate contract and doesn't come under the CISG. Yes, please.
If goods are delivered and payment is made, does payment show conformity with the goods?
The payment of the price would not necessarily imply acceptance of the goods in these terms. This is not like in the common law, the notion of the perfect tender, where you receive something and you accept, you can either reject it or accept it. If you accept it and pay the price, then that's the story. You cannot rely on lack of conformity for as a justification for claims. That's not the case of this CISG. You may have paid the price because you agreed and paid the price in advance. This CISG itself, in principle, says you are not bound to pay the price until you had a chance to examine. But again, the entire CISG is subject to party autonomy, so the contract may require advance payment. You agree to that, but that doesn't mean a waiver of your right to claim lack of conformity. Yes, please.
I have a question for Article 42.
Yeah.
Yes.
It is for that article irrelevant against whom that claim is made. It is also even irrelevant whether the claim actually exists at that point in time. There may be a notice of a claim, there may be a risk of a claim, and the claim may arrive later on. What is important for that is that the goods have to be free of any claim based on intellectual property rights in the place where the goods were supposed to be used, if that is known to the seller, and if that is not known to the seller, in the place of business of the buyer. Because claims for intellectual property infringement are territorial in nature, as you know, that any intellectual property claim is exercised and enforceable within a certain territory. And if the claim is would be against the seller in the seller's own land, that would be relevant and would not affect the sales contract, because what matters is where the goods are supposed to be used. Okay? Yes, please. That article is not concerned with the merits of the claim, right? You may have an existing patent, in which case it would be obvious, or you may have a nebulous situation where that is not 100% clear. And the question is, are you as a seller, were you supposed to know that there was a third part with a possible right? And that's what is the controlling element for that article. Okay? Then let's move on then to the remedies of the buyer under Article 46 of the CISG. The first remedy of the buyer is to demand performance, right? The buyer would also have the right to demand the delivery of replacement goods under certain circumstances, that is when the goods delivered are lack conformity to such an extent that that lack of conformity would constitute a fundamental breach of contract. And the buyer also has the right to request that the seller correct the lack of performance of the goods within a certain period. Okay? These are three remedies available to the buyer under Article 46 of the CISG. Now, let's look at them one by one. The right to demand performance, what does that mean? That would mean the right even to sue the seller and to obtain from a court a judgment forcing the seller to deliver those goods that are promised to the buyer. In other words, the right to demand specific performance. Now, we know that specific performance is available in some legal systems, but for instance, is not available across the channel. Common law countries do not recognize the right of specific performance unless in very, very exceptional circumstances. The normal remedy under the common law is damages for breach of contract. And the notion that a court cannot force a party to perform under a contract. Civil law not only recognizes that, but some civil law jurisdictions go even further and allow the court to impose a penalty per day of delay in performing under the contract. This is something that would be rather unacceptable for most common law legal systems, but is possible under civil law. And was one of those points, again, that was no agreement possible. And what the CISG contemplates is that the buyer would have the right to demand performance if that remedy would have been available to the buyer under the applicable law. Meaning, if the seller is in France and the buyer is in the UK, the UK buyer would have the possibility of suing the seller in the French court and obtaining from a French court an order to deliver those goods. And that order would be enforceable. You can even go with a court bailiff to seize the goods and deliver them to the buyer. If the situation was the opposite, now the UK is not a contracting state of the CISG, say the seller is American and the buyer is Mexican, and the Mexican buyer sues the American seller before a court in Los Angeles, it would not obtain that order. And the contract would then, the court would award damages but would not award specific performance. So specific performance in the CISG is subject to law outside the CISG itself. The second important element to bear in mind when it comes to the remedies of the buyer is that the possibility of rejecting the goods and avoiding or terminating the contract is not always available. It would only be available if the lack of conformity by the goods is of such a nature that it would make that breach of a fundamental breach, and you see in a moment what that means. Many civil law legal systems that following old Roman law on sales would recognize the right of the buyer to reject the goods for any lack of conformity, no matter how important or unimportant it is. You simply have not delivered what you have promised to deliver, I can reject the goods. It is it's a recognized right in the nearly all civil law legal systems. Not so under the CISG. So the delivery of the defective goods under the CISG is not per se a fundamental breach of contract. For instance, if the goods are repairable without unreasonable cost to the buyer or inconvenience to the buyer. So what is then a fundamental breach? And fundamental breach is a fundamental concept of the CISG. Fundamental breach, which needs to presupposes also a notice by the buyer to the seller of lack of conformity of the goods. Fundamental breach means a breach that causes such a detriment to the other party so as to substantially deprive that party from what the party would have been entitled to expect under the contract. This comes close, this formulation, which is not, up to then was not very familiar to civil lawyers, comes close to the common law notion of frustration of a contract, which is one of the bases under the common law where you can terminate a contract. It's not exactly the same concept. Frustration means typically that the performance of the by the buyer, by the seller, or other circumstance that supervening the contract rendered that contract something that deals something fundamentally different from what you had bargained for, and that would allow you then to terminate the contract. Here is basically saying the seller delivers something that is so flawed, so defective, or so radically different from what the seller had promised to deliver, that contract has no economic value or practical value anymore for the buyer. Unless the party in breach could not foresee that would be the consequence of the breach of contract. This sounds very abstract right now, and I'll try to make this clearer with a few examples from practice. As I said, it's not every single defect of the goods is not the fact that the goods are not exactly the same goods that are promised. There has to be a fundamental change for the buyer in terms of the usefulness of the goods to allow the buyer to terminate the contract. For instance, if I purchase fair trade coffee beans and I made it right into the contract, I'm buying fair trade, certified fair trade coffee beans, and I inform the seller, I am supplying coffee shops that serve only bio-certified fair trade coffee, right? And in this area, I have no other marketing possibility or sale possibility for these beans, because these are the only coffee shops that I supply, the only coffee shops that buy coffee beans in this part of the world, right? And the seller supplies coffee that is not certified. And if I cannot sell those coffee beans to anyone else, those coffee beans have absolutely no value to me, because my only buyers only buy certified coffee beans. It would be a different thing if I'm saying I buy Arabica coffee and the seller delivers to me a mixture of 60% Robusta and 40% Arabica beans, right? It's not exactly the same coffee that I wanted. Perhaps I will not be able to supply Café Landmann and Mein Lam Graben with that coffee, but I'll be someone else who's gonna buy that coffee from me. And that makes that bridge non-fundamental, because I'm not deprived from the economic value of that. I would have some inconvenience, yes. I'd have to look for a different channel of commercializing that coffee and selling that coffee, but I'm not deprived of the fundamental value that provides to me under the contract. So examples from case law would be where non-conforming goods, as this example, cannot be sold without unreasonable and inordinate effort by the buyer. If the, you know, or also if the buyer is a tradesman that sells that poultry to the Middle East, right? That means all that chicken has to be halal chicken. And now all of a sudden the seller delivers chicken that was made for the European market, so it's not halal chicken. And now all of a sudden that buyer has to find a completely different channel to sell those goods, because there's not for the normal customers. It would be then for the court to consider whether that would be a reasonable additional cost for the buyer to incur, or whether it would be an excessive cost in the circumstances that the seller should have been aware of, that the buyer would not be in a position to so easily dispose of goods that do not conform to the contract specifications. Now, late delivery, for example, would not necessarily be a fundamental breach, and actually, in principle, it is not. It is only exceptionally when the delivery date is absolutely necessary for the goods to be usable to the buyer. For example, seasonable goods, fashionable goods that, you know, the delivery of winter fashion in the winter itself, when already the stores are in the process of filling up their stocks for the spring and the summer season. And that unless the buyer will be in a position to relatively quickly and easily dispose of those goods, probably also for a lower price, it might amount to fundamental breach of contract if the buyer would not be in a position to do so. Obviously, always if the seller would manifest to the buyer that is not either willing or in a position to perform under the contract, that would always constitute a fundamental breach of contract. The same thing would be the insolvency of either party. That leads the other party to expect that the party will not be able to perform under the contract, or placing the seller being placed under receivership and will not be able to dispose of the goods for fulfilling the contract with the buyer. Or, for example, if the buyer refuses to open a letter of credit to the benefit of the seller. And that means that the seller would bear the risk of a possible later non-payment by the buyer, and then you have already shipped the goods, but you have not seen your money. So you have the right to demand, I'm only delivering the goods against a letter of payment. If you're not, I'm not letter of credit, if you're not willing to open a letter of credit to my benefit, then there is no deal. And that would be also a fundamental breach of contract. Conversely, as I mentioned, late delivery by itself is not considered by courts generally to constitute a lack of conformity, unless time was of essence. I mean, also, you needed the goods for a particular fair at a particular point in time. There is no use for you if they arrive later. You need to furnish the room for a conference, and you needed the seats there for that particular conference. And after that, we'll be dismantling that installation. And if they arrive 2 weeks later, there is no use for you. So you can terminate the contract and still claim damages from the seller. As for the quality, it always depends on whether the buyer can use or resell the goods. That would always be the criterion used by courts to determine whether there is a fundamental breach or not. If that is not possible, the breach will be fundamental, but as long as there is that possibility, you will not be entitled to terminate the contract. And the two examples of coffee, or the example I gave you from the halal poultry, it all depends on what is your marketing channel. If you have access to a channel of disposing of those goods and you can sell them without unreasonable cost, then will not be a fundamental breach to entitle you to terminate the contract. Also, because the CISG, and here is one of the remnants of old Roman law in the CISG, gives you the remedy of price reduction. Those that are familiar with continental European sales law know that we inherited from Roman law basically two remedies under the sales of contract. Is the remedy to reduce the price for defective goods, and the remedy to reject the goods if the seller delivers something that does not match the goods that were promised by the seller. The CISG also recognizes that right, the right to reduce the price in proportion to the diminished value that they have for the buyer. So far, so good. There is nothing extraordinary in this provision. As for early delivery, it would be at the choice of the buyer. The buyer can choose to take the goods at earlier date, but also always has the right to refuse early delivery. The same would also be apply to delivery in excess of the quantities ordered by the buyer. But if the buyer takes excess delivery, obviously he has to pay for the goods taken in excess. So what is important also then to bear in mind here is that under the CISG, the notion of breach of contract or lack of conformity is a so-called unitary one. The CISG does not distinguish in detail, as some legal systems distinguish between defective goods and different goods from the ones promised, or the alius and peius, as you would probably say under Austrian law. And the same goes for a breach, and it comes of also the treatment of remedies. Price reduction has to be proportionate to the lower value of the goods delivered, and would also be not be available for late delivery. The other remedies, as particular damages, would apply in case of late delivery. Now, remedies of the seller, they are fairly more simple than the remedies of the buyer, because the buyer's obligation is a simple one. The buyer only has to pay the price and take delivery. So the seller may fix an additional point time for the buyer to pay. And the lateness of payment, as I mentioned to you, is not by itself a fundamental breach of contract, unless if the seller has stipulated an additional period to the buyer to pay the goods, and buyer would not comply also with that additional period. By the way, this also applies both ways. If the seller has delivered defective goods or non-conforming goods, defective goods, the buyer has the right to demand the correction of that defect by the seller and give the seller an additional period to perform that, something that you would call Nachfrist under German Austrian law. And if the seller then does not perform at that date, that would then constitute a fundamental breach. And at that point in time, then the buyer would have the right to terminate the contract. So remedies of the seller, the additional period to perform must, however, be reasonable according to the circumstances of the case, including commercial usages and practices established by the parties. That is, if there is a margin of tolerance in the dealings between buyer and seller, and that the seller has tolerated up to a week or 2 weeks of late payment by the buyer, it would be unreasonable for the seller to demand punctual payment and do not tolerate late payment and give you only a short period to pay and consider that to be a fundamental breach. That would be, again, against the underlying principle of estoppel also that underlies the CISG. If the seller allows the buyer to believe that it has always the possibility of paying with a grace period, then that grace period cannot be taken away in an unreasonable fashion. Obviously, a definite failure to pay the price would constitute a fundamental breach and would entitle the seller to terminate the contract. Now, before we move to damages, breach, and impediments, have questions on this part? Yes, please.
Does partial performance of contract exist under the CISG? If I am partial, for instance, if there is a contract for all the chairs in the room and they only deliver half of them, obviously we don't need the other half, but it's still a breach. However, the setup may argue, well, I still partially perform, so I'm just paying half.
It does exist, but it's not. You don't get out of it that easily. The CISG would not consider that to be a fundamental breach, in principle. However, if you are the only supplier of those, if you are the only supplier of those chairs, there is no comparable one from which the buyer can furbish that room, that may become a fundamental breach. But assuming that's not the case, and these are kind of off-the-shelf type of chairs, the seller delivers only half, the buyer is not entitled to declare that a fundamental breach as long as he can still get from someone else, but the extra cost of and price of getting from that someone else would be charged against the seller for damages. So it's part of the damages that the seller would have to compensate the buyer for. The CISG upholds the principle of full compensation of damage, and that would be one case. Yes?
Well, perhaps to add to that, a question. So just so I understand the payment, the delivery of the other half of the chairs still, that are still required, would not fall under performance under 46.1, or would it be done by a damage claim?
I can always demand performance. And but if the seller is not in a position to deliver, then I can get the goods from somewhere else, and then the seller would be liable to me for damage for the extra cost. But I always have the right to demand that. And in that case, if then the what happened is if then the seller would declare that he cannot deliver the remaining part, then the contract would be terminated for the remaining part, but the seller would be then liable for damages. Yes?
Why is it that early delivery mistake constitutes a breach of contract, whereas late delivery would be considered whether there's like a market for it to why is there this distinction between early delivery and
simply because in early delivery, the problem of early delivery is that you may not be prepared at all to receive the goods at that point in time. You'll be incurring an extra cost for that. In case of late delivery, the arrangements are already made, right? And the problem is simply that has not arrived at you in time. And that's the basic difference. It's basically the logistics of dealing with one or the other situation. Very quickly, because we have to slowly then move to our guest speaker for today. Yes?
Just one more question. As a buyer, should I inform the seller that it is crucial for my business to receive this goods in time, like for my internal reasons, not connected with seasonal or not connected with the other? Very complex reasons. Should I inform the seller, or I can disclose this information?
Well, the answer is not that clear cut. It would always be a good practice and wise for you to do so if that is so crucial for you. And in principle, if you have not done so, then you'll not be able to claim fundamental breach because the seller has not complied with that particular purpose that expected from the goods. However, and you see in case law, the courts may come to the conclusion that the seller should have known. It depends on the trade. You know, if you are buying and selling, if you are a florist and the seller is a flower farm, right? The seller should know that you need those goods within 24 hours and that there will be no use for you if they deliver a week later. So in principle, yes, you have to make known. And in principle, if you don't make known, you are not allowed to invoke that as fundamental breach. In practice, there will be situations where a court may infer that the seller should have known that you needed them by a certain date, for example. Yes? The CISG recognizes that interest is part of the damages to which the seller would be entitled. It doesn't set the rate of interest. That's a different story. Okay. Thank you. Now we will have for now when we would be dealing with breach and damages and performance, we have the second guest speaker of this series. and you see the guest speaker is already connected. It's Professor Alejandro Garro from the Columbia University. Professor Garro is originally a trained lawyer from Argentina, but has been a professor at Columbia University for a very long time. He's admitted to practice in Buenos Aires, Madrid, and New York. He is also a member of the CISG Advisory Council. He has lectured in many universities and written many books on commercial law and law of commercial transactions, and currently writing a second edition of a book on concept for international sale of goods. Has also participated in many international negotiations dealing with the unification and harmonization of international sales law. And Professor Garro would be explaining to you hardship under the CISG, and also using the unusual times we're living at currently as an example, as a threat to his lecture. So without further ado, Alejandro, please.
Thank you very much, Jose Angelo, very kind of you. And I'm very pleased and honored to be part of this virtual anniversary lectures. I can hear an echo, and the first question I have, other than us hoping that you're safe and well, is whether you can hear me and see me well. And if not, we can do the adjustments, Jose Angelo, that are required. Can you hear me well?
We can hear and we can see you well. And in case you cannot hear questions, and then I'll be then repeating the questions to you, Alejandro.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
I expressly chose this press in presence type of approach in the absence of being able to be in Vienna with you, because rather than pre-recording lecture, I find it much more interesting to be able to at least see your faces from a distance with a mask, but yet willing and interesting and connecting with each other about this subject that we will be discussing today. I hope that the echo I'm hearing, it's only me and you are not annoyed by the echo, but in any event, I appreciate, Jose Angelo, that this, and I said to the students already at the very beginning, you are the main addressees and beneficiaries of this presentation. So anytime you have any questions, please feel free to either raise your hand, connect, let Professor Jose Angelo Estrella Faria know about it, or myself. But I think that the subject that I will try to discuss with you really puts into context what you already have done with Professor Estela Faria, which is actually put into context what type of transnational rule or international law do we have, not in the broad context of international commercial contracts, with which I understand you're very well versed already, but on the very specific issue that is actually affecting our lives for years to come, but definitely today, which is the outbreak of the COVID-19 pandemic. This COVID-19 pandemic has two characteristics that are extremely interesting for us to be sharing. One, that it's international, global in its impact and its effect, and the outbreak measures that have been taken by governments to contain the virus actually has affected all legal systems, no matter what is the nature of legal system, how old they are, or what their civil law or common law nature. And it has affected the legal system in various ways, starting from individual freedoms. Many countries have to adopt some kind of a state of siege, state of alarm, state of emergency rules in order to be able to contain the virus and actually constrain people to stay home with lockdowns and prohibitions of transportation costs and so on and so forth. So this actually a pandemic has an international global impact in many areas of the law, constitutional law, administrative law, contract law too. And in the area of contract law, where we are going to be actually focusing our attention, it definitely has very tragic and dramatic consequences on very heavily regulated contracts, such as consumer contracts, insurance, and employment contracts. And you probably will know by just reading the newspapers of every day that the problems with laborers and the relations between employers and employees, and the problems of claims filed with insurance companies for these consequences of this pandemic are already being multiplied in many courts. And I think that it's important to bear in mind that where we're going to be focusing today are all specifically also in contracts, but not on residential leases, on which we know there are many governmental measures, I'm sure, including in Austria, actually limiting or confining the authority of the landlord to evict the tenants. In many countries, if not in most, there have been a moratorium adopted by governments, postponing or prorogating the time for paying rents, for paying consumer loans, and so on and so forth. But what happens with commercial contracts? All the commercial contracts have been disrupted, heavily disrupted by this pandemic, not always in the same way, and not everybody, but just think about the many commercial leases of restaurants, construction companies, mergers and acquisition deals that were entered into before December or January of this year without having made a specific provisions on the possibility that this pandemic could be extended, or the impact of the pandemic for be extended for such a long time. So what we are seeing today now are many provisional or interim measures of protections in arbitration and litigation that are being requested by lawyers on behalf of their clients who are unable to perform or pay under their contracts. And many also bankruptcies. Here in the United States, there are many bankruptcies that are taking place actually. And in the verifications of the creditor's claims, the issue that comes up is whether or not the obligor or the party has been affected by the pandemics can have an excuse either to suspend performance or just simply not to perform. And these are very controversial issues that I think we're going to be seeing in the years to come. Of course, many of these issues are going to be settled generally by settlement, by thoughtful negotiations between the parties. But I think that in many other places and in many other countries, in many other cases, the parties to the contract are going to say, I will say, a contract is always a contract. We'd made a deal. We didn't provide for the deal. And if we didn't provide for the deal and the performance becomes much more onerous or excessively burdensome, well, that's the problem of the obligor who is subject to that performance. And if the obligor or the party did not include some kind of a contractual clause providing for that possibility of this extraordinary event, in that case, then it is assumed implicitly that you assume the risk, the seller that the prices will go down and the buyer that the prices will go up. And the same thing in other places. But I think that my interest is here in approaching with you with this problem is that in the same way that the pandemic and the impact of the pandemic is global and universal, nevertheless, the answer, the response of the legal systems is not unique. And you will see, and this is my job today, to tell you that the menu of the varieties of responses of Austrian law, German law, even Swiss law, legal systems that are closely related with each other, with the same language perhaps, and very similar legal culture, they don't have the same answer. And if you go to the Spanish-speaking countries in the area of the world where I'm more conversant, you will find that Spanish law does not have the same answer than Chilean law or Argentine law or Brazilian law. So I think that it's important to bear in mind there is a great diversity of responses. And my purpose today is just giving you a very, of course, unavoidably with the 45 minutes that we have, superficial panorama of the variety of responses in the domestic legal area. And because in many of the domestic legal areas, this is the law that is going to be applied, even if the contract is international, because not all international contracts are governed by some kind of international rule. National law always have a rule. Then you as lawyers or as potential arbitrators or judges will have to face the problem, which law should I apply? How should I construe it? And on that point, let me bring to your attention in the first place, what is the area of commonality? In other words, what is the language that every legal system speaks on the same page? Perhaps there are only two wrote bedrocking legal principles. One is that contracts ought to be performed as written. And this is a famous pacta sunt servanda provision, which is ingrained in most civil codes of the world. The other one, also common ground, is that if the performance becomes impossible, but I mean actually, objectively, really impossible, then no one can require the obligor or the debtor to perform that obligation. That makes eminent sense. There may be varieties in some legal systems. Some systems say that if the performance was impossible at the time the contract was concluded, then the contract is void. As opposed to other legal systems that say that in that case, it's not that it's null and void, but the party can terminate it with some consequences about the remedies for that. But that is a minor point. The important point is that pacta sunt servanda and impossibility of performance are actually both principles that even though they are in tension, they find easily recognition. But what if the performance of the contract is short of impossible? In other words, you can perform, but that performance really goes beyond any reasonableness because the performance has increased in value in an outrageous way, or the performance has decreased in value for the other party in a way that it doesn't have any more value today. Well, in that occasion, then we have a variety of concepts and legal doctrines. The probably most well-known of all is the force majeure concept. Force majeure being a French term, which has been actually adopted not by all legal systems, but many legal systems recognize force majeure as a sort of a ground for an excuse not to perform. But force majeure really is equated almost identically with impossibility. Force majeure clauses generally refer to an act, what they call an act of God or an act of the prince, meaning that there's a law or a governmental action that impedes you or hinders or prevents you to perform. But you will find that probably in Austrian law, you will find the principle that contracts ought to be performed, the principle that impossibility of performance actually is a defense. But also you may find that there is a defense of force majeure. And in many legal systems, including, I believe, the Austrian legal system, the influence of the law of the church, of canon law, felt itself being articulated in one word or expression that is mostly known by the Latin term clausula rebus sixtantibus, going back to the basic canon Latin law formula, meaning that the contract ought to be performed, that's fine, but as long as the basic assumptions and the basic contingencies and presumptions that were in place at the time the contract was concluded remain in force. If those assumptions, those bases, those foundations of the contract actually change in a way that is unforeseeable and drastic, in that case, there could be a defense that gives different names in different legal systems. The French call it the theory of imprévision. The Germans speak about the Störung or the Wegfall der Geschäftsgrundlage, the collapse of the foundation of the contract. Other legal systems speak about excessive onerosità sopravvenuta. There are different words, different concepts. And it's a very problematic for lawyers, judges and arbitrators at the time, they have to actually enforce one of the contracts and deal with disputes about this to determine, first of all, which law would apply. And if we know which is the law that would apply, and it's a domestic law, how to apply that law? What means force majeure, close to impossibility? What means excessive onerosity, unforeseeable change of circumstances? These collapse of the foundation of the contracts, these varied from contract to contract, from obligation to an obligation, and from fact to fact. So I will provide you the very easy answer that lawyers, non-committal answer that most lawyers do. Whether or not you will be able to find refuge in the case that because of the pandemic or the consequence of the pandemic, you are unable to perform or the performance has become increasingly onerous, then it will depend. What is your contract? Is that a contract of lease? Is it a contract of construction? What does the contract say? Even that the contract has a clause providing for this. What is the obligation that actually is being affected? Can you still perform? Can you still perform in part at least? Well, these are the answers that legal systems give different different answers. And let me just give you a very basic dichotomy, and please, again, interrupt me at any time and feel free to do so, between the common law tradition and the civil law. They don't speak with same voice. England, English law does not speak the same voice that US law, neither does Swiss law speak with the same voice than Italian law on this issue. But there are some commonalities. First, in the common law jurisdiction, which include obviously the mother country, England, as well as the US, Australia, New Zealand, and all the British Commonwealth countries. Well, in the first place, they don't know about the word force majeure or hardship, except in the context of a clause in the contract. So when you speak with an English or an American lawyer, if you speak about force majeure or hardship, don't speak about the doctrine of force majeure or the doctrine of force. They speak about clause of force majeure, meaning if you don't have in the contract one force majeure clause or a hardship clause that actually provides that the parties will meet together again and renegotiate the terms of the contract, or that there is a price index that will vary according to the circumstances of the case, or that if there is a disruption in the supply chain of the seller, that they will be, then if you don't have that clause, then English or American law have short answers, don't have a clausula rebus sextantibus to rely on. But at the beginning, late of 19th century, English courts started to devise the doctrine, what they call the frustration of contracts. And it's a very well-known contract in the early 1900s because it came about as a sort of a frustration of a lease contract for a balcony to watch the procession of a king that fell ill. And therefore the one that, that who had paid for the balcony only to see the procession of the king wanted his money back. And he actually got a result by the English court saying that the contract had been frustrated. The very purpose, the very objective end of the contract have collapsed, and therefore there is no more contract there. That law of frustration of contract, it was later on codified in England regarding what the remedies are. And of course, the US law adopted it as part of the common law of contracts, the law of frustration of contracts. Let me tell you, however, that there you will see very few cases in England or the United States where the frustration of contract theory has succeeded. Nevertheless, that you will have factual scenarios where there is a possibility to do that. On the other hand, if we move to the civil law countries, we will have there, again, the variety of contracts, not only force majeure, which is adopted not in all countries, but in most civil law countries, in some provision which the French Civil Code, the Napoleon Code, adopted and later on was adopted in other countries. And in addition to force majeure, you would have another provision in most modern civil codes. And by most modern, I mean those civil codes adopted after the 1940s, after the Italian Civil Code, which will have some provision dealing with hardship, meaning force majeure for close cases that are actually close to impossibility, and hardship for cases in which it's not, there is no impossibility, but there is economic, financial difficulties of such a sort that requesting the pound of flesh, requesting the contract to be performed as written, is really a violation of the duty that contracts ought to be performed in good faith. So in those countries, you will have that defense, either force majeure or hardship. Not in all countries. Remember, most are countries that have adopted the recent countries. The French Civil Code, which is the paradigmatic civil law countries from where all other civil codes have been modeled, including the Austrian one. Well, that French Civil Code did not have any provision on hardship from 1804 until 2016, when they amended it and they included a reformulated definition of force majeure and a reformulated definition of hardship. And they actually put it as two different defenses. When one will play or the other would play depends on the facts. And most lawyers and their advice will probably bring the two defenses just in case one is not working. But other countries, Spain, which still has a 19th century civil code that has not been amended, Chile, which is also has a 19th century civil code, which has not been amended and has been a model of other Latin American countries, they don't have a provision of hardship. And so their courts have a hard time trying to come up with a clausula rebus sextantibus defense, with a hardship defense, which actually the case law tries to somehow prefigure in a way, configure it in a certain way. But again, that is domestic law. And in many international contracts, which is what we want to address our attention, you will find that that domestic law of those countries will be applicable, and therefore we will have to make a distinction between force majeure and hardship. But what has been the experience with domestic application of force majeure and hardship in most of these countries? Well, I think that no matter if it's common law or civil law, in most jurisdictions you will find that arbitrators and have the basic presumption that if you did not include a clause in your contract, that then you have assumed the risks that circumstances will change because the contracts is nothing is static and things change. And therefore, if you didn't include a clause in the contract, tough luck, and you're likely to have assumed implicitly the risk that circumstances would change and that you would have to bear the full burden of this pandemic, which probably did not allow you to open your restaurant in months or to actually buy goods from other countries also in months. So this is a problem that you should bear in mind, that even if you have a contract clause, even if you have a background doctrine of force majeure or hardship, courts are very reluctant to apply it. But there are circumstances where they are being applied. And again, think about the fact that we're facing today. Even though the pandemic may have been, by some stretch of imagination, conceivably foreseeable, because hardly anything is unforeseeable today, and there have been various outbreaks of pandemics before in the world, and people who have actually anticipated this kind of thing, the consequences of the pandemic, the measures taken by governments, was probably not foreseeable in most instances, depending, of course, when the contract was concluded, where it was concluded. But in generally, you will find that arbitrators and judges will have an open mind to see what the circumstances of the case were. And this is when, again, you would have to face the situation of, if there is a clause, how do we interpret that clause? If there is no clause in the contract, what background doctrine can we apply? And on that point, I'm going to make one point, and I'm going to just make a pause for a minute because Professor Stella Farias or you can have questions about this. And is this, remember that even if you have a clause in the contract, there will be variations in the approach to the interpretation of that clause. First of all, whether it's an experienced arbitrator, an experienced in international commercial contracts, or whether you have a domestic educated judge whose only education is in his own domestic legal system, that may make a big difference because the judge probably is going to be conversant in the applicable law of his own country, but probably not so much in the law of a foreign country or in some international customs or rules. So that's one problem. The other problem that you may find is that English and American lawyers, the common law lawyers in general, have an approach to contract interpretation, which is not the same as we have in the civil law. And that's very much exemplified in Article 8 of the Vienna CES Convention. I'm going to go to this Vienna CES Convention in a minute, but now I'm going to discuss with you contracts in general. And the Article 8 of the Vienna CES Convention actually extrapolates one rule that is very much applicable to all kinds of contracts in most civil law jurisdictions. The judge or the arbitrator is to take into account not only the words of the contract. Of course, that's the primary concern, but he can or she can go beyond. And she can go to the content, the negotiations, the conduct of the parties before the contract or after the contract. Well, for a common law lawyer, that's a little bit shocking because the common law lawyers are used to generally many times to have the idea that contracts ought to be interpreted within its four corners. In other words, that every interpretation of the contract is subject to what the words of the contract itself, and that it's not allowed to go beyond those terms of the contract unless there are very specific circumstances that would make an exception. This is what is called in Anglo-American countries, the parole evidence rule, which is a rule that really quite different from the liberty that civil law judges have in actually have a contextual approach to interpretation of contracts. Now, if we don't have a contract clause and we have to, and which is likely to be the case in many contracts concluded before January of 2020, or December or March of 2020, in which case there could be claims or defenses based on the on force majeure, then in that case, you would have the question of determining, can you contract out? Can you opt out from the rules of the civil code on hardship and force majeure? The general answer is yes. unless we are talking about consumer insurance, labor contracts, if we're talking about typically commercial contracts, most Western legal systems, not all of them, but most Western legal systems would provide that you, of course, can waive whatever rights you can have under the doctrine of force majeure or hardship. But, and this is why it's important, I want to stress with you again, that the best defense against pandemics or this kind or any type of extraordinary events is to have a clause in the contract broad enough to actually encompass your case that can harm. And the problem becomes more acute if the contract is international. Because if the contract is international, then the parties are from different legal cultures. They come from different countries. The answer in the domestic law of those countries is very different. So the best advice, again, would be go to the try to negotiate a well-drafted force majeure clause or hardship clause. And you do have sources, helpful sources to rely. The International Chamber of Commerce does have, they charge a fee for this, but you can find it in Google. You can find a model clause on hardship and a model clause on force majeure. And for both kinds of clauses, you would have alternative remedies. That is to say, depending on what type of trust or confidence you have in the dispute resolution system that you have provided, the ICC model clauses on hardship and the ICC model clause on force majeure will give you some leeway to actually options to provide for one term or the other. On this point, I bring to your attention one important point. All of these clauses have some sort of a specific clause saying that the force majeure clause will be triggered, for instance, in case of a fire or earthquake or tsunamis or acts of God or acts of government, import restrictions, export restrictions, and so on and so forth. I warn you that there always would be some catch-all phrase, however, saying that any other event that actually hinders or prevents the performance of the contract and that is unforeseeable beyond the control of the parties and on which the parties have assumed a risk will also be a ground. But be careful with this. Some countries in some jurisdictions, this is very typically the case of New York, unless the force majeure clause, unless the event, the impediment, the problem actually falls squarely within one of the examples of the force majeure clause, then courts will kind of be reluctant to give you an excuse not to perform or to suspend performance. So I think you've got to be careful again in how to draft that clause, depending on whom do you think is going to interpret or apply that clause. If you don't have a clause, then we are left with doctrines. But fortunately, if the contract is international, there have been so much water under the bridges that in the last 20, 30, 40 years, in addition to the Vienna Sales Convention, whose 40th birthday we are actually celebrating, there are other instruments, many international instruments, that provide for different answers. I'm going to get to that point. Before doing that, I'm going to make a pause to see if you have any questions or concerns. But what I'm going to discuss later on is what is the answer of the Vienna Sales Convention, which is the hard treaty law applicable in more than 90 countries, as well as other many international instruments. And there are various instruments in different regions of the world, all of which include some hardship and a force majeure clause. So the problem is going to be similar and common, but there are some variations among them. And doctrinal scholars, as judges and arbitrators, may have different opinions on it. And I'm going to discuss this in a minute, not before reminding you that UNCITRAL came out recently with a very, very helpful, what they call guide. Again, this is soft law, but a very useful guide, not only for you students, but for lawyers, judges, and arbitrators in general, which is known as a tripartite guide, because the three main law formulating agencies, UNCITRAL, UNIDRA, and the Hague Conference on Private International Law, got together, and they drafted a document, extremely pedagogical, in which they tell you what are the relationships among the many soft law and hard law instruments governing international commercial contracts. And they include all those contracts on which you're going to hear a very rich menu of conferences next week. You have conferences on bill of ladings and letters of credit. You have a conference on many other aspects of transportation of goods and other kinds of issues. Well, that tripartite guide is going to give you a good coordination among themselves, among those rights, specifically with the CIG, how the CIG, the Limitation Convention, and other treaties relate with each other, in which way you can apply one to fill a gap in the other. That's extremely helpful. But let's make a pause. Professor Sila Faria, Thomas, I don't know whether there are questions on part of the audience that I should address now. Let me know.
Any questions for Professor Garro at this point? No, Alejandro, carry on, please.
Thank you. All right. Then, in that purpose, I want to just bring you that the law of excuses under the instruments that we have here, rather than adopting the idiosyncratic terms such as the collapse of the foundations of the contract, like the Germans do, or unforeseeable circumstances as the French and Spanish-speaking countries do, and that sort of thing, they try to adopt, at least agree on terminology. And they agree on two, that there will be obviously impossibility of performance, again, outright physical or legal impossibility, which will always be a ground for defense adaptable. But there will be a defense of hardship and a defense of force majeure. Mostly legal instruments today make the distinction between the two. And as I said before, there may be a difference of degree, but they are very similar in the fact of the factual scenarios in which they are presented itself. That's why probably one lawyer advisably would present a defense of force majeure. And alternatively, if that wouldn't work, they would present a defense of hardship, saying that there is not impossibility of performance, but actually very difficult to perform. I'm not gonna bring to your attention three or four documents, but because of reasons of time, I have thought of focusing on those documents, but you will find in yourself a more easy one. There are at least four or more soft law documents. In the European Union area, which has achieved a high degree of integration more than others, you will find that in the 1990s, already there is a principles of European common law that introduced for the first time in section 6111, provisions on hardship. And they have their own provisions of hardship, similar but not identical to the ones that were later on provided by the draft common frame of reference, which is a sort of an embryo of a European civil code enacting the starting of this century, 2008, that actually also incorporate a provision of force majeure, a provision on hardship, similar to the European principles on contract law, but not again, not the same. And for those of you whose contract is with people in other regions of the world, such as Africa or such as Asia or Latin America, there you will have some soft law, at least draft of soft law. In the Latin America, there is a principles of Latin American contract law. There is an Asian principles of contract law, all of them in the making, but the drafts are there and you will see that they include also provisions of force majeure and contract. And finally, you would have another text, much more widespread and used at the global universal area, which is the UNCITRAL principles on international commercial contracts, which since the very beginning in 1994, at the very beginning included a section on this, probably one that has been served as a model in the amendments of 2016 of the French Civil Code. In the amendment of section 313 paragraph, the three of the BGB of the German Civil Code and other civil codes in the world, this UNCITRAL principles principles text does include three provisions on hardship that I definitely would like you to watch at some point and discuss and examine with your professors. One is section 621 that gives you the fundamental principle that the mere fact that the contract becomes or an obligation becomes more onerous does not give you an excuse to not to perform. But then becomes 622 that says that if there is an alteration in the balance of the performance, a serious, grave alteration in the balance of the performances, be because one performance becomes excessively onerous or another performance becomes valueless, that in that case, you may then bring up an issue of hardship as a defense not to perform and request in that case, different types of remedies. We'll get to the remedies in a minute, but I want you to focus the attention that the unit of principle distinguishes. 622 is what are the thresholds, what are the requirements for a hardship defense to be met. This third article, 623, deals with what are the remedies. And both parts, I think you should distinguish it. And within a few minutes that I have left to complete my presentation, I will try to make a comment on both of the differences between two aspects. One is the issue of the elements that must be met in order for the defense of hardship to be met. And there are three elements, which you will find replicated in Article 79 of the Vienna Cells Convention, which did not adopt neither the UNCITRAL principle, which did not exist at the time. The Vienna Cells Convention was adopted in the 1980s. The UNCITRAL principle didn't come about until 1994. But this does speak, this Article 79, of an impediment. What type of impediment? It doesn't define, it doesn't say force majeure, it says impediment. But it gives you three elements, which you will find in most offenses of force majeure and hardship. First, it got to be an impediment that is beyond the control of the party who claims its occurrence, the obligor, the party aggrieved by it, affected by it. Secondly, it must have been unforeseen or unforeseeable. There is a difference between the two. And actually, the idea is not that it had been completely unforeseeable, because that again may be extreme, but it could not have been reasonably taken into account by the parties when they concluded the contract. That is the threshold. Of course, it's not an easy one, and the burden of proof is in the party claiming, of course, that the hardship, but it is, but it's there in Article 79. And the third element is that even if it's an impediment that is beyond the control and whose risk the party did not assume, even in that case, you must prove that it is unavoidable and insurmountable. In other words, you have those three elements that the old doctrine of force majeure had in French law, that it has to be externality, unforeseeability, and inevitability. All those elements are there, easy to articulate, extremely difficult under a specific factual scenario to prove. But again, think about the outbreak of COVID-19 and think about specific problems that you may have as a lessee, a tenant of a gallery which doesn't have any more customers, as a restaurant owner who cannot open anymore the restaurant, or can open only the restaurant up to 25% of capacity and receives only 10 or 20% of the revenues that it was expected to be received. Construction contracts where the supply of goods, it becomes actually close to impossible. There are many factual scenarios. And the first thing I wanna advise you is that under Article 79 of the CISG or under UNCITRAL principles, the judge or the arbitrator is going to look closely. What obligation are you talking about? Was it real? Is there a causal relationship between the impossibility or the impediment and the failure to perform that obligation, or to delay or stay the performance of that obligation? That causal relation is going to be important. And the judge and arbitrator also is going to take into account, did you make every effort to try to mitigate the harm that unforeseeable event took place? For instance, in the case of restaurants, we already have decisions here in New York, the court saying, holding that, well, if the restaurant is closed, but nevertheless could accept delivery orders from customers, that nevertheless, that is a way of earning a living, and that therefore did not give you an excuse not to perform, or at least give you only a partial perform not to perform, because you could still make money by just putting the food on in the corner, or for some delivery person to give it to the customer. But of course, that's not the case of all restaurants, and therefore a factual case-by-case scenario would be extremely important. And getting now to the very end of my presentation, I will tell you a couple of points that are important. There is no mathematical formula indicating you what is the threshold, what is the elements, the minimum of, or the elements of sacrifice that you can request from a promisor or an obligor who fails to perform. In other words, if the price increased 50%, 100%, 5 times, 10 times, there is no rule that is going to give you a mathematical rule saying that threshold, that minimum element of difficulty, of hardship, It has to be proved, established on a case-by-case basis, depending on what type of contract you're talking about, a long-term contract, a short-term contract, was a speculative contract, what type of obligation was there involved, and so on and so forth. And you will get some general approaches. Judges and arbitrators are going to be reluctant to give you an excuse if what you cannot do is pay money. Because they're always unlikely to say, well, you can go and borrow the money, or you can always find an alternative source of funding. And of course, they don't rule out. There could be possibility of financial ruin, which actually was brought about only because of the pandemic and not out of your own fault, in which case the judge or the arbitrator may take into account. I'm just saying that if the obligation is to deliver, to do something, or deliver something, yes, your defense is more likely to be heard than if what you cannot do is pay or not pay such an amount. And that has been really a constant in much of the case we have seen in New York, and not only in New York, in many other civil law jurisdictions too. Even the obligations to delivery, if that is the problem, is failure to deliver or to deliver late, well, you gotta be clear about deliver what. Because if the goods are generic, fungible, you can find them anywhere, then probably the judge or the court may say, you should have got and purchased that oil, gas, or merchandise or goods in the market, and then give it to the buyer, and then go and sue for the difference between the contract price and what you paid for the cost of replacing that transaction. That may well be the case. The point I'm trying to make is, it's very important what is the obligation that is being hindered or impeded on the obstacle, under Article 79, as well as the others. And then comes the question, and with this, I will be concluding, which is the question of, if you have a case which really squarely falls under an impediment or the type of excuse that meets all the requirements, and that you can actually establish that is the type of excuse, what can or should you ask for, or can you ask for? And on that point, again, the variety of solutions and remedies found in domestic legislation is astonishing. And also, you will find different varieties in the international rules, soft law and hard law. Let's first look at the soft law and then go to the Article 79 of the CISG, which is actually the focus of our attention. If you go to soft law, like the UNCITRAL principles, the principles of European contract law, and the draft frame of reference, you would find that in most of these provisions, they go as far as to say that in the first place, you could have to keep going, performing, but that you have the right, in some cases the duty, but in many other cases, you have the right to request renegotiations. And that is something that not other legal systems provide. And again, and I think you should make a difference between a duty to renegotiate and the right to renegotiate. First, because the right to renegotiate, you cannot deprive it. Every party who is affected by this pandemic is likely to ask the other party to renegotiate the terms in good faith, either because they have a multi-tier dispute resolution clause calling for mediation, amicable solution, or even if you don't have that clause, before you go to the contract or to the arbitration, you may want to ask precisely for that type of assistance. And if that doesn't work, the question is, what happens if that de facto good faith renegotiation don't work? Well, it's very unlikely that any judge or arbitrator will attach some damages because you didn't renegotiate. What probably may well an arbitrator or judge do is, well, let me know what were the terms of renegotiation. If you failed, try again and meet again and try to encourage the party to renegotiate under the threat that if you don't do it, I'll do it myself. That may be okay. But on that point, I want you to remember that most legal systems don't speak with the same voice. You have a German approach influencing other countries where they provide that the privilege remedies adaptation. In other words, the termination is the ultima ratio. You cannot terminate a contract. It's a too drastic remedy. If it's a possibility of adjusting the performances in a way to restore the equilibrium, rebalance them, well, the judge or the arbitrator has to do that. For other jurisdictions, including the common law jurisdictions, that's anathema. Judges are not meant to rewrite the contract for the parties. And besides, the solution of adaptation that the court or the arbitrators may give is going to come too late because generally decisions on the merits on these cases take hundreds of days or years, it's likely to be too uncertain. You never know what type of adaptation the judge or the arbitrators might want to take. So in many jurisdictions, the only thing you have is the remedy of termination. And many other jurisdictions, and with this, I finish on the ultra of the domestic law, what you have is only if you're the aggrieved party, ask for termination. The possibility of adapting is on part of the defendant party who wants to uphold the contract. Only that party can ask the judge or the court to adapt the contract. That's the model of Article 1467 of the Italian Civil Code, which has been followed in many, many civil law Latin American jurisdictions. The final point, what about Article 79? And with this, I conclude. 79 doesn't speak about force majeure, doesn't speak of surge, hardship, does not speak about the duty of good faith. There's no such a duty of good faith, neither of adaptation. The only thing 79 paragraph 5 says is that the party who has actually makes his case and can be excused does not have to pay damages. By extension, most of the doctrine allows that if you don't have to pay damages and you're excused, really you don't have to do specific performance either. What is not clear is what other remedies are there. Well, the CIG provides one remedy, extremely useful, that not all legal, modern legal systems provide, which is the possibility of terminating. And that is in Article 26 of the CIG that gives the party which has been affected by this pandemic the right to request for termination. And that right can be exercised under Article 26 without having a court decision, a unilateral and by declaration. And that will trigger, again, that threat of termination, if it was a real excuse, will probably conclude and deal with the possibility of the parties actually settling the case. Final point, as you can see, no one size fits all model, and even Article 79 of the CIG is susceptible of different interpretations. The Advisory Council adopted opinion number 7 years ago, and now recently edition number 20, much more articulate insofar as the remedies are concerned, that I suggest that you may want to consult in case you will find some sort of a unified harmonic the interpretation of Article 79. I remain to your questions. And I'm sorry, Professor Estela Faria, if I went beyond in a minute or so my presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Alejandro. Do we have questions for Professor Garro? I would have one for you, Alejandro, which is, I think for you is an easy one, but does the cost increase of a transaction due to an unforeseeable event amount to an impediment under Article 79 of the CISG?
My first answer under the terms of Article 79 is yes. Why? Because 79 speaks about an impediment. It doesn't tell you about whose impediment, whether it's in cost, increase in cost or an increase in other types of performance. And therefore, I think that prima facie, you have that that answer, Angelo. The problem that I see with an increase in cost is that if it's an increase in the price cost of, let's say, of goods, be commodities or any kind of goods, then you would have a hard time establishing that actually was unforeseeable or not reasonably, could not have been reasonably taken into account at the time of concluding the contract. And the second point that you will have difficulty is if it's an increase in cost, Angelo, how much of an increase in cost? And we have decisions really saying that an increase in cost of 10%, even there's a Hamburg decision on that point, if the contract was really speculative and in the area of steel tubes, for instance, prices and cost increased dramatically from decade to decade. So the arbitrators or judges are very reluctant to give that. But if you're talking about an increase in cost on in an area where the market has really been stable for many, many years, then you have a better case. And this is why, I'm sorry to answer the question, only a yes, but always exceptions, depending on, of course, circumstances of the case. Sorry to answer that way.
Thank you, Alejandro. Then a very quick one, Alejandro. If few years ago, the Belgian Supreme Court decided that parties had a duty to renegotiate a contract to try to overcome an impediment under Article 79 of the CISG. Did they get it right or wrong?
Thank you. I will tell you, I think they got it wrong, and tell you why. I think that's the more important part. This is the decision of the Belgian Supreme Court of June 19th, 2009. And I think it's an important one because there was an increase on part of the seller in 75% of the price of the steel. And the buyer again sued for adjustment or termination. There were different responses given by the lower intermediate court of appeals and by the Supreme Court of Belgium. The intermediate court of appeals said that French law applied. At the time, French law did not had any law on hardship. And when it went to the Supreme Court found it is made a decision on which I think at least was wrong in one very important aspect. The Supreme Court of Belgium said that Article 79 did not deal with that problem. Why? Because it was not actually impossibility. And if it was not actually impossibility, the Belgian Supreme Court understood by impediment being objective outright impossibility. Well, that's not what 79 says. And I think that today, not everybody, but the weight of scholarly and judicial and arbitral doctrine said that 79 includes a scenario both of hardship or a force majeure, or close to impossibility. And therefore, I think that the Supreme Court did not need to go to the UNCITRAL principle of international commercial contracts or to international customs to come out with the application of the UNCITRAL principles when they had already Article 79. If 79 was applicable, and again, on that point, I open no judgment because I would have to be more in the shoes of the court. But yes, I can be in the shoes of the court on the question of the application of 79. I think that 79 should have been applicable and not a gap being found and resort to an outside source, which in this case was the UNCITRAL principles, and it's very controversial whether the UNCITRAL principles can apply to a case where the Article 79 actually covers that scenario. And the Advisory Council has a very opinion, both opinion number 7 and 20, very clearly in the sense that 79 envisioned both as sceneries. That, in that sense, I think that opinion was wrong, and then your question deserves an outright answer.
Thank you very much, Alejandro. And I also thank you for joining us. I know that you have a class immediately after this one, so I appreciate that, and we now move on with our course here. Thank you, stay safe, and all the best to you in New York.
Thank you, and all the best to you.
Thank you, Alejandro, thank you.
Now, before we continue with our other topics, would be now be breach, damages, and the consequences of the avoidance of the contract, for which we have now 1 hour, and I'm pulling out my presentation. You may wish then that we have a chance to discuss with your colleague from the UK, the cases concerning this Suez Channel decided by the House of Lords in the UK. These are good questions, cases concerning impediment, force majeure, and hardship. And I hope you took away from Professor Garro's presentation, first of all, the fact that terminology here is very misleading because different legal systems use different categories. The common law would talk about frustration. The civil law would talk about force majeure. In German, you'd say Höhere Gewalt, which is similar to force majeure. And then some instruments talk about hardship in the sense of something that happens that makes the performance become more onerous and costly. And then there are legal systems that talk about impossibility of performance, impossibility sometimes meaning something that happens before the formation of the contract and makes the contract avoidable, or something that happens afterwards and prevents proper performance of the contract by the parties. This CISG does not use that expression. The CISG talks in Article 79 about impediment, exactly to avoid these confusions. If you look at Article 79, and I'll move back to the other text about an impediment beyond the control of the party that the party could not have reasonably expected to have taken the impediment into account at the time of the conclusion of the contract or have avoided or overcome its consequences. And what Article 79 does, as Professor Garro says, is that it will excuse a party from the consequence of not having been able to perform. Now, you ask then your colleague from the UK what happened in the Suez Channel cases, and those cases involved carriage of goods from India to the United Kingdom, and then after the close of the Suez Channel in the 50s through the Egyptian government, they had now to sail not through the Suez Channel, but all the way down around the Cape of Good Hope in South Africa. And the carriers were trying to get away of those contracts because they had become, all of a sudden, three times more expensive to perform. And the House of Lords said no, because it is fundamentally still the same obligation. You have to carry goods between India, Bombay, and Liverpool, and nowhere in the contract is written that you have to carry them from Bombay to Liverpool through the Suez Channel. If there is no Suez Channel, we have to go around the Cape of Good Hope. Other legal systems might have provided a different solution for that. That's not the case of the common law, and is not, in principle, the case of the CISG. The CISG is very reluctant to allow you to invoke a mere cost increase. It has to be something coming close to impossibility of performance, but also, as Professor Garro said, it will depend very much on the particular context. But a simple increase in the cost of the price of your commodity you are supposed to deliver would never amount to an impediment under CISG, because these are circumstances that should be foreseeable for any party in ordinary commercial transactions. Now, in this part, I'd like to focus on breach, damages, and we already heard impediment, breach and damages. The CISG also allows the parties to perform what we call the anticipatory breach. That is, if it becomes apparent to a party that the other party will not perform, the CISG allows you already at that point not to perform your own obligations, or either to suspend the performance of your own obligations, or if the other party will commit or is obviously likely to commit a fundamental breach, also for you to terminate the contract. The idea behind this, again, has to do with mitigation of damages and mitigation of losses in case of breach of contract. Most legal systems would accept that if you have not performed an obligation, you cannot demand the performance of my obligation. And then whenever you demand the performance of my obligation, I could use your non-performance as an excuse. The CISG goes a step beyond and allows you to actively suspend the performance in case there is a non-performance by the other party, or to avoid in case there's a fundamental breach by the other party. Why? Because the CISG doesn't want you to incur the cost of performing where it is obvious that you would eventually have to litigate with the other party to obtain the other party's performance. So then it allows you already at that point not to fulfill your obligations under contract. And examples of situations where it would be possible for you to exercise these remedies under Article 71. Obviously, a declaration by the party that you do not perform its obligations. But if the seller deliberately suspends the delivery of goods in installments or sends some installments, but they deliberately suspend further delivery of goods, if the seller refuses to commit to a date for delivery, and tells the buyer, no, I won't be able to deliver by that date. Why don't you buy goods from somewhere else? That's sufficient indication that that seller won't be able to perform its obligation of the contract. Why should the buyer be obliged to perform under that contract and pay the price? A seller that says, I'm sorry, I'm having difficulty finding the goods that you need. Can you would accept other alternative goods? That's already sufficient indication that that seller would not be in a position to perform the contract. Would have been reasonable to consider the buyer bound by that contract. So that's the notion of anticipatory breach under the CISG. You can not only declare the contract avoided once a fundamental breach has already occurred, you can also do it in anticipation of a breach by the other party. Now, it comes to a breach, right? The party has not performed its obligations. As I mentioned to you, the CISG then recognizes the principle of full compensation of damages under Article 74. The compensation of damages under Article 74 would cover loss, including loss of profit, subject to a test of foreseeability that the party that was affected by the breach would have suffered that damage. You would know that from domestic law that each legal system in a way limits damages for breach of contract. Many of them would use a test of causality, of causation. And this, the law would say that the party in breach is obliged to pay all the direct damages resulting from the breach by the other party. Right? That would exclude so-called consequential damages, a damage that happens as a consequence of another loss sustained by the party. The CISG uses a different test, and that's the test of foreseeability. And that is what the party in breach should expect or should have expected that it would be causing to the other party by the breach of its obligations. Another important element to bear in mind, if you see that formulation, the party has to pay damages, including the actual loss and loss of profit that it could have foreseen. There is no reference there to the fault of the party in breach. And that makes the CISG the damage mechanism in the CISG independent from the proof of fault. The only way a party in breach would not have to pay damages is if that party is able to invoke Article 79 on impediments. Right? So in a way, it's a significant reverse of the burden of proof as compared to many legal systems, particularly in continental Europe, that makes the obligation to pay damages conditioned upon proof of fault by the party in breach. In those legal systems, the injured party has to demonstrate that the breach by the other party was due to that party's fault. For example, the delivery of defective goods was due to the negligence of that party in either purchasing or manufacturing the goods. In the system of the CISG, that negligence is in a way implied. So the logic of the CISG is if you delivered faulty goods, it must be your fault. It must be because you're negligent, must be because you didn't do something right. And the only way you can escape damages is under Article 79. If you can prove that this was because of an event that was unforeseeable to you and was beyond your control, what you have just heard. So it is a system of damage independent from proof of fault. Now, that doesn't mean that the analysis of the gravity of the loss would be completely independent from considerations of domestic law, because the proof of damage, it would have to follow the rules of civil procedure of the competent forum. And then you would have, then you maybe come to situations where the depending on the system of proof of damages, you may not get the full foreseeable damages that you could in theory get under the CISG. But that's not because of the CISG, that's because of the operation of domestic rules of civil procedure. The question of set off is one that until recently is considered to be determined by the applicable law outside the CISG. There is a recent opinion of the CISG Advisory Council that advocates for a solution of the right of set off damages under the general principles of the CISG. But until recently, it was considered to be something outside the CISG, because then it would be the question whether what kind of a credit I can set off against, you can invoke against me to set off against my claim for damages, whether it can come from the, has to come from the same legal relationship out of the same contract, or has to come or can come from a legal relationship outside the CISG contract. This is why until recently was considered that set off has to be regulated by law outside the CISG. And as we know, the CISG does not cover damage by injury caused by the goods to persons, but it can cover the indemnification that the buyer had to pay to a third party. So now let's go analytically through this provision on damages under CISG. The first category of recoverable loss under the CISG is obviously what the part in breach failed to provide to the other party, what the promisor failed to perform to the promisee. And that is the non-performance loss. So that begins by the difference between the objective value of the goods and the values the value they would have had they been in conformity with the contract. Okay? So you get back to the coffee beans example. I know that fair trade coffee beans are more expensive than uncertified non-fair trade coffee beans. Right? And already that price difference is the first element of damage. I didn't get what I was supposed to get. I'm entitled to that difference of damages. Now, is the damage curable? In the case of the coffee beans, they're not curable. But in the case of motorcycles that are delivered and the painting is not finished, so I have to do an extra finishing before I'm able to resell them. So they are repairable, but there'll be a cost in repairing them. That, again, also an immediate loss sustained by the party that would be automatically covered by the CISG. Or I am a buyer of a sewing machine. I have a Nike franchise and I make sneakers in, most of them nowadays are made somewhere in Eastern Asia, Bangladesh or Sri Lanka, and I manufacture sneakers there. And the sewing machine arrives late and I have already a delivery that I have to meet. I have to rent a replacement machine. That, again, an immediate loss at sustain, which is immediately recoverable under the CISG. In the case of breach by the buyer, then currency devaluation would be an example. I am a seller in Turkey, And as you know, the Turkish lira have been devaluating recently. And you are a buyer here and you purchase some grocery products because you resell them on the Nash market. And you pay me 1 month late, and by that time the lira has already devaluated 15%. It's an actual loss. It's not a consequential loss, and that is immediately covered. Then comes the second category of losses covered by the CISG, the so-called incidental loss. And incidental loss are expenses incurred by the party that are not related to the diminished value of the goods or to an immediate need to hire other goods, but by having to take other measures that relate to the replacement of the goods. For example, renting a substitute sewing machine, as I mentioned to you, that's an immediate loss, right? I'm substituting the good that you should have delivered to me. Now, it happens that the only available sewing machine that I'm renting is also has to be installed in my factory, right? And that will incur an additional cost to do that in order to be able to use that machine to produce. That would also be covered by the CISG as incidental loss. Or if the goods you deliver are not of the quality that we had agreed, and then we need to process them, right? They're not only they are worth less than those that you promise, but I also will need to have them clean, for example, to use for whatever purpose I need them from. For example, again, the coffee beans example. I wanted coffee beans that are certified, but they're not only certified, they would come obviously completely peeled, right? And you deliver coffee beans that are not entirely peeled. So they'd have to go through a machine with a huge ventilator to free them from that peel, right? The same would apply to peanuts or something similar, right? That's an additional cost that will incur because you have delivered non-conforming goods. It is an incidental loss. It's not a direct loss. It is an incidental loss. It's also covered by the CISG. Or you are late in delivery. I have to arrange for shipping of substitute goods, right? And the available source of substitute goods would say, it takes me 1 week to get them to you. And I said, but I need them in 3 days. I said, well, then I gotta ship them by plane, and that's gonna cost you more. That's an additional, also it's an incidental cost, right? And depending on the circumstances, it should have been foreseeable to the seller that they might incur that cost. And that cost would also be recoverable under the CISG. Or if the goods are unusable to me, right, and I have to return them, or especially because I indicate as a buyer to you as a seller, I cannot use these goods, and you seller said, but I can repair them from you. But now I have to customs clear them back to you, ship them back to you. And these are also incidental costs that I will incur, and you should reimburse me for that. The other category that is covered directly by this CISG is loss of profit, right? These are what you call, in some legal systems, you call them indirect loss, right? They're not the direct loss, but they're indirect in the sense that you are prevented from making a gain on those goods, on those goods. And since the CISG is concerned with goods that are not meant for personal, family, or household purposes, a large portion of it would be goods intended for being resold. And if I'm expected to make a profit on those goods, I should be able to recover the profit that I didn't make from you because of your breach of contract. But that is also not only that loss, that's a loss of a gain, may also have the nature of an immediate loss in terms of business interruption. You again, let us get back again to the example of the sewing machine. The sewing machine didn't arrive in time. I had then to rent another one. Direct loss, the rental. Then I had the incidental loss, which was the installation, the cost of hiring the workers to install that in my factory, right? And because of that, there were 3 days that I couldn't produce. And I lost 3 days out of my business cycle. Also, that is a loss of profit that would be recoverable under the CISG, right? Or if the delivery of non-conforming goods increases the production cost, right? Also, that too would be a recoverable loss under the CISG. An example, another example could be if you run biofuel plant, right? It's a plant that processes vegetable or animal fat and recycles that produces fuel, right? Now, if my machine requires, say, vegetable oil, used vegetable oil, but filtered and pre-cleaned, right? And deliver oil that is dirty or that is not to the purity quality that I would require, my machine is then likely to operate at a slower speed or would have an increased maintenance cost because it would have to be cleaning the machine more often or would experience other problems. That is again a loss that I'm incurring because I have a higher unit cost now. Now, what I expected to be able to sell is to be able to sell the fuel for a certain amount. The fuel is actually costing me more because it costs me more to produce it. I have to stop the machine 5 times a day. My crew and the factory needs to clean it 5 times a day. That slows down my production process. Also, that would be a loss that would be recoverable under this CISG as a loss of profit, right? Now, how do you determine that? Well, it's just a question of evidence, of course, but normally you'd be using the aggrieved parties in this case would be the buyer's usual margin of profit over the products as a basis for calculating the amount of loss that would have been sustained by the party. One thing, however, that this CISG does not cover is the so-called disgorgement of profits. That is, I am as a party in breach, and actually I breached the contract because I got a better offer from someone else, and I don't have enough of that product to supply both customers. So I prefer to supply to the second, and I make a profit on the second deal, and obviously, it's more favorable to me. There are legal systems that would allow the buyer, in this case, to obtain from the seller also that difference. It's basically as if it were a punitive damage. so as not to allow that party to make a profit on that party's breach of contract. It sounds like a moral proposition, right? And it sounds like one that would encourage party to stick to their promises. But this is not covered by the notion of damages under the CISG, because the damage under the CISG has to be a loss. The profit I made on that other contract may be immoral in the eyes of some, but it's not your loss, it's my profit, and as such is not covered by the provision of damages under the CISG. Then we now get to a category which is slightly more, well, the treatment is slightly more nuanced. And those are the so-called consequential damages. So your non-performance causes me a damage, and that damage in turn causes another, a second generation of damages, right? And here are two examples you can see from case law on this particular question. If I had intended the goods for being delivered to a third party, right? And I cannot fulfill that contract, of course. I've sustained one immediate loss, right? Which is the loss that I sustained by either having to been unable to perform my contract, or because I needed to hire those goods from somewhere else to perform the contract. Now, the cost incurred by my customer, for instance, because my customer was actually the ultimate customer of the sewing machine, right? I was just the intermediary in that transaction. If now it is then the customer that has to rent the machine from someone else, that's the customer's damage, right? And that would not be, as a consequential damage, would not be covered by the CISG in principle. The same thing, for instance, it is if there is a litigation and with one, for instance, in this case, was when one of the carriers or a freight forwarder. And because of that litigation, the buyer had to pay attorney's fees. Well, that, again, is a consequential damage. And the logic in the CISG is that this level of damages would only be recoverable if they were foreseeable to the party in breach at the point of the breach of contract. If the party could foresee that would happen. If I have indicated, for instance, that I am purchasing this machine to fulfill a contract with one of my customers who runs a factory and would need that machine by such a day, then it will have an easier case for attributing also those consequential damages to the party in breach and obtaining recovery. But if that is not the case, then it will be very difficult to recover consequential damages under the CISG. You have here examples also found in case law. One of them, the seller must have been a commodity trade. The seller had chartered a vessel for the shipment of the goods bought by the buyer. The buyer fails to provide a letter of credit, and as a result, then there's a fundamental breach of contract. Now, the seller is left with a chartered vessel, right? Buyer may try to argue, saying, but I had no idea that you would be chartering a vessel that would not be simply shipping the goods by normal means to me. that maybe the seller would be able to demonstrate you should have known that, because in this trade, in this commodity trade, that's the way goods are shipped. We never put them on the regular ship on a container. You typically charter a vessel for that transportation. So you cannot claim that you had no idea that I would be sustaining that consequential loss of being left with a vessel for which I have to pay and for which I have no use, right? The breach of contracts with the buyer's customers. Again, one thing is the immediate loss. I'm not able to sell the goods and I suffer this immediate loss, which is the price difference and the loss of profit. But the damage that I have to pay because I breached those contracts, or my reputational loss, because now I've now lost the clientele because now they no longer trust me because I broke on, I breached those contracts. These are consequential losses that may be recovered under the CISG to the extent that they were foreseeable to the party in breach. But this is more less of a clear-cut situation as the other three categories of breach, consequential loss. So they may be recovered, but they have to meet very clearly the foreseeability test, which is much easier to meet in the other three categories of breach. Any questions on damage? Yes, please.
Why didn't the CISG decide to go for the test of foreseeability instead of going for the test of facility? Is there a world of space again?
Because the notion in the CISG is that it's not written anywhere in this CISG, but also underlying the CISG is the notion that ultimately performance is your decision, right? This is a notion that's very familiar to the common lawyers, that you assume an obligation, you perform and non-perform, and a common lawyer cannot be compelled to perform, right? In the civil law, you can sometimes, in the common law, not. But if you choose not to perform, then you should be liable to anything that you could anticipate, expect that you'd be causing to the other party, right? And the causation may actually cut that bill short and leave the other party with damages that would not be covered because they cannot say that these are the directly caused by that damage. Right? This was to place actually the burden more on the party in breach is following the principle of full compensation. Because if you have a system of direct causation, first, you might have a difficulty in establishing a claim for loss of profit, and you might also have a difficulty establishing a claim for incidental damages. Right, but on the other hand, you base your system of damages on the notion of what a tradesperson should normally expect to happen as a consequence of its actions, and that was the choice that CISG made. As I mentioned before, there are different systems operate with different categories. But that would allow the parties already at that point in time to anticipate other remedies also in terms of insurance, in terms of alternative protection against the consequence of the loss. If you say it's whatever you anticipate at this point in time would be your bill if you breach this contract. And the consequential loss actually may get you also very far, depending on the circumstances, if you can prove a chain of consequence. But the chain may be beyond what you could have anticipated at that point in time. That is the logic, the reason why it was, this as you chose this system. Two more, yes? Yes. What? Attorney's fees. Mm-hmm. There are cases on the CISG that said no to that, because the hiring of an attorney to demand payment of a claim is not necessarily foreseeable to you. I mean, I can simply send a letter on the CISG and demand payment. I don't need to hire a lawyer to do that. If there is litigation, then it's another story that may become a consequential damage that could have been anticipated. But hiring anyone simply to claim my credit against you is not something that is necessarily foreseeable, because also it's not everywhere usual practice in trade. Okay?
With regards to the recoverable losses and curability, there is a provision in Austrian domestic law that states if the value of, or if the costs in recoverability would be, or in curability would be higher than the actual value of the goods, then the curability should not be assumed to be a viable option, or rather the higher costs of curability should not be, be recovered. Is there a similar reasoning in CISG, or is are curability costs just recoverable regardless of how high they are?
No, there is always a test of reasonability in the CISG, and also in both ways, because, for instance, if you deliver goods that are not conforming to the contract, I'm only obliged to accept them if it is reasonable for you know, the cost of making them conform and suit my needs would be reasonable for me. Maybe that the goods are not of the quality expected, I can sell them, that's a different story, and I cover the price difference. But if I need those goods, for instance, for processing, and I will need them to make them fit in order to be usable in my process, I'm only obliged to do that if the cost is reasonable. If the cost of doing that is unreasonable, then I can simply terminate the contract for a fundamental breach of contract. Okay? Yes? Two more? I will get to mitigation of losses the next point. Yes. Please. Yes? Sorry, I didn't understand your question. I couldn't hear you. Could it try to speak up a bit? Yes.
I was wondering, does the article 74 also apply when the party asks to terminate the contract in the case of article 72, paragraph 1? Because I thought, like, isn't to terminate the contract like a way of mitigation of damages?
Damages under the termination of a contract and any of the remedies provided under CISG are always cumulative with damages. They never exclude damages. You can always claim damages in addition to whatever other remedy that you can exercise under the CISG. So I can suspend my performance and still claim damages, right? Because you are late already in the first two installments, and I had to incur other costs. So the one thing does not exclude the other. So the damages are cumulative always with the remedies, including termination of contract. Okay? Then let's now move to the point of mitigation of loss. The philosophy of the CISG is, as I mentioned to you before, you have to also reduce the cost for yourself and for the other part, including your own loss, even if your own loss is the result of the breach by the other party. And that is clearly said in Article 77. It says the party who relies on a breach of contract must take measures that are reasonable in the circumstances. You see that. To mitigate the loss, including loss of profit resulting from breach. If the party fails to do so, It can claim damages, but the damage would be reduced by the amount that that party failed to reduce by failing to take a mitigating measure, right? Examples of parties that fail to take a mitigating measure. Get back to the coffee beans example, right? You breached the contract, you delivered wrong coffee beans, or you didn't deliver the coffee beans at all. And now I have this open contract that I need to fulfill, right? And all I do is to look whether in the immediate vicinity I can find someone who can supply those coffee beans to you. And I could have looked also in a neighboring country, I could have looked in a next market if that is reasonable, right? And if I fail to do so, I'm not mitigating my loss, right? Again, it all would depend on the circumstances. If your supply market is southern Japan, you would not be expected to be necessarily looking for an immediate supplier for you from Venezuela or Colombia, right? You could also look beyond, or maybe in Indonesia or in Java would be someone who would be able to supply that to you. It would depend on the market, it would depend on the circumstances of the case. But you cannot simply present the entire bill to the other party without having making any effort to try to fulfill your contracts. You cannot simply say, well, you have not delivered, and because of that, I have failed on all these orders, and now you will have to pay me the immediate damage plus lot of profit plus all the penalties and other costs that are arising out of termination of these contracts. That would be unreasonable in terms of negligent behavior in avoiding loss in accordance with Article 77 of the CISG. Another example you can see here, a party that fails to conclude cover purchases. The example your colleague was giving before, the company delivers only 1/3 or 2/3 of the chairs that I need to furnish this room, right? And I could have bought the other third from another company, perhaps would have taken me a little bit more of time, would have taken me a little bit more of effort. I don't do that, and instead simply I leave the room unfinished, and now I present to the seller also the penalty that I had to pay under the construction contract because I didn't perform correctly. And the owner of the building is now charging me that for failure to perform under that contract. And if the seller can demonstrate that it would have been easy for me to make a cover purchase for that, that would not be too difficult to find those chairs, or would not have been too difficult to find the coffee somewhere, then the damage that I'll be able to claim would be diminished by the appropriate amount. Or another example, the buyer discovers that the product is defective. One of the examples that you have here on the screen is the use of defective wax for sealing wine bottles, right? And the buyer, rather than immediately stopping the use of it, allows the factory to continue using until the stock is finished. And 6 months or 1 year down the road, it gets all these claims from the customers saying this wax is breaking. And so these bottles are not properly sealed, right? Now, a diligent company at that point in time would have immediately stopped using that defective good. And if they fail to do so, they're also negligently causing the rejection of those goods by their own customers, who are not entitled to claim full damages under that contract, right? Or the buyer who goes ahead and makes shipping arrangements for collecting the goods from the seller, despite the seller in having informed the buyer he won't be able to deliver by the date. In this case, again, the buyer is doing nothing to mitigate its own loss, right? And now it's not reasonable to present the full bill for chartering the ship to the seller if it was the buyer's own negligence that caused that situation. The buyer would have been reason for the buyer to immediately contact the charter and say, can we push this date back? Or in this case, not charter the ship at all at that point in time and wait until a point in time when we could reasonably expect that it would be able to collect the goods at the time foreseen in the contract. Or knowing that there will be either a late delivery or partial delivery or perhaps an unsatisfactory delivery by the seller, the buyer does nothing to cancel subcontracts or other sales it would have already concluded at that point in time. Again, then in that case, that buyer would not be entitled to claim full recovery of all those costs because it failed to mitigate its own loss, right? We talk about breaches, and you'd like now to conclude with the effects of avoidance of a contract. Now, any questions on mitigation of loss from your end? That should be clear. Now, effects of avoidance, you have two elements here. What happens when you avoid a contract, you terminate the contract, and what happened to the goods and which duties the parties have in respect of them. So avoidance obviously means that you have to undo the contract, right? The failure by the seller amounted to a fundamental breach. The buyer had no use for those goods. The buyer declares the contract terminated. Now, you have basically to reconduct the parties to the situation where they were if there had been no contract and no breach of contract due to the fundamental breach by one of the parties. There would have been no avoidance of the contract due to the fundamental breach by the parties. So the party that has performed the contract is entitled to restitution of whatever it has performed, and the party who has received performance is obliged to return that. So far, so good. Now, this is not different from what would happen under most legal systems. The buyer loses, however, the right to declare the contract avoided or require the seller to deliver substitute goods if it is impossible for him to make restitution of the goods. Again, this is something that should be familiar to you under most legal systems. If the goods have already been consumed in the buyer's factory, of course it is impossible to make restitution of the goods. And all we can do when you terminate the contract, you avoid the contract, you have to regulate that through mutual damages, right? So what we have in Articles 81 and 82 is basically a framework for establishing what will happen between the parties afterwards. So buyers are released from the obligation to pay the price, sellers are released from obligations to deliver the goods, and however, goods and performance already received would have to be returned to the other party. If they cannot be returned, they have to be returned in value. There is no specific provision in the CISG for the place of restitution, but the CISG provisions on the place for the seller's delivery can be applied by analogy. That means I would have then to return the goods to that place in which they would have considered to have been delivered to me. So if you, our contract provided for delivery of goods alongside the ship in the port of Liverpool, that would be the place of delivery of the goods after avoidance of the contract. Now, more interesting than restitution, which is in the CISG not necessarily novel and different from the regime of restitution under domestic law, is the notion of the CISG of preservation of goods. And that is something that is maybe different from some of the domestic legal systems. But it is coherent with the notion of mitigation of loss under the CISG that even if I avoid the contract as a buyer for a fundamental breach by the seller, I am obliged to preserve the goods and not allow the goods to perish so as to be able to perform appropriate restitution of the goods after avoidance, right? And I would, of course, be entitled to recovery from the seller the reasonable cost that I have incurred for the preservation of the goods. So again, even if the breach is caused by the avoidance is caused by the fundamental breach by the other party, the party in possession of the goods has to preserve them. The same also applies to the seller. If the buyer goes bankrupt, is unable to pay, so that situation would amount to fundamental breach of contract, and I, in anticipation of that, declare the contract avoided, and the buyer has not collected the goods yet. I have to preserve them, and rather than simply letting them perish and then presenting the entire bill to the buyer as part of the damage that is sustained under the contract. So that means that there is a duty of duty to preserve the goods that is a corollary to the notion of mitigation of loss, but also of good faith in international trade. So I should not be negligently putting the other party to the in the contract in a more detrimental situation that they would necessarily have to be simply because I don't take any measure to preserve the goods. However, I'm always entitled to compensation for the reasonable costs that I have incurred. I'm not obliged to go out of my way to preserve the goods. And if I do so, I might also be doing so at my own risk. I might not get those costs fully recovered. And the party in possession of the goods would be entitled to sell them in case of unreasonable delay by the other party in picking them up. And if the goods are perishable, Article 88.2 would even impose an obligation on that party to sell those goods, again, for the purpose of mitigating damages. All right? So you see that is a system that's conceived to take into account the logistic difficulty of international trade, the fact that restitution is not automatic, may take a very long time, and may be that the restitution would not even be possible given the nature of the goods. And that is why the CISG then imposes this obligation to preserve the goods that are in possession, even if you are in possession of the goods because of the delay or the breach by the other party. Any questions on that? So if you have no questions, then we're coming to a conclusion on this presentation of the CISG. Here you have, you've seen this map, colored areas are the countries that have ratified the CISG. You see there are a few spots in the European continent. One of them was closed a few weeks ago when Portugal ratified the CISG. Now the only countries missing in Europe to ratify the CISG are the United Kingdom, Ireland, Malta, and Cyprus. All other countries have already ratified the CISG. So this is this sales law and entire covering the entire European continent. But it covers also, as you see, all the larger economies in the world. The CISG entered into force coincidentally with the deposit of instruments of ratification by the United States, China, and also Italy deposited at the same time, as very significantly China and the US deposited the ratifications at the same time. So 94 countries. They represent 2/3 of the trading goods. And the CISG, as I mentioned to you, by numbers of ratifications, is only second to the New York Convention on Recognition and Enforcement of Foreign Arbitral Awards. The CISG, however, does not have a court to ensure its uniform application. And that's why UNCITRAL produces a certain number of guidance documents and publications to ensure the interpretation of the CISG, in particular case law on the CISG, but also there is a digest where you have as a book all the case law applying the CISG, and also most recently, as Professor Garro mentioned, this tripartite guide with UNIDROIT and the Hague Conference that explains how the instruments prepared by the three organizations can be coordinated, synchronized, and applied together in international commercial transactions. That would conclude this two lectures on the CISG. On 19th, Monday 19th, there will be a special conference with special guests on a more celebratory note on the CISG, and I thank you for your attention. Look forward to seeing you there. Thank you.